What's up, guys? Wallow J here, and I'm here with my co-host,
Heart of War. And we got a special guest, Selina.
Hey, how's it going?
From Black Hive Tattoo, one of our official sponsors. And then, of course, behind the boards, we have producer Chris.
Hello.
I want to need you to bring that energy a little bit up.
No, he's fine. I've already got his level set for that energy. Don't mess with him.
No. He sounds like, you know.
He's tired, bro. Leave him be.
I'm tired. He worked out.
Leave him be.
It doesn't matter.
Leave him be.
I'm tired, too.
No, leave him be.
I'm tired, too, bro.
I thought you said you're Thai, too. Can you speak Thai?
That too, bro.
You're like, I would like the Thai tea with pad Thai.
Yeah.
Prom rom.
Why are you making fun of my accent?
It's not. I was giving you like a Cali accent, actually.
Whatever.
I would totally like a prom rom with an amazing chicken.
Screw you. How about that? Mm. Anyway, we got Selina from Black Hive Tattoo. Not only does she do tattoos, but you hunt too.
Yep.
She has all sorts of hobbies.
Where did you grow up that you started hunting? I mean, because you don't hunt here in Florida, do you?
Yes. Yeah, yeah. Actually, I do. So I hunt in southern Georgia. I hunt in South Florida. I hunt in Virginia, and I hunt in Texas.
What are you normally hunting for?
Most of the time, it's population control of wild boar, because they are extremely destructive animals, and they taste good. So
I was just going to say, bacon.
No, they're terrible for bacon.
Really?
Okay, so domestic pigs have a lot more fat on them, and they have a lot more extra meat to them. So a wild animal is a lot more lean, and the fat is a little bit different. It's actually considered something called tallow, which is more of like a waxy consistency versus like fat on domestic animals. Like, and it increases like the flavor, and it makes bacon taste good. So
like candy.
Damn, she's dropping some real knowledge in this bitch.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't want that waxy bacon.
The wild boars, they don't have a good pork belly, like a good pork belly to them, like a one of the nice pink pigs.
Yeah.
So you can't do shit with them.
Usually so what would be the best cut for a wild, you know, hog?
Tenderloin, ham hocks, sometimes the pork chops.
Shoulders.
Shoulder. Yeah. Really, really good meat.
Which is weird because the shoulder is actually called the pork butt.
Mm-hmm.
So the Boston butt?
Yeah, the Boston butt. That's actually the shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
So
why do they call it that?
I have no idea. It's the way it's always been labeled since way back.
Yeah. We usually wind up field dressing them, and then we quarter them down, and then we put them in an ice bath for like 3 to 4 days with like a little bit of vinegar and just kind of cut down like the
gaminess of it.
Well, the gaminess, and then also it cuts down like the protein, and it actually softens the meat up a little bit, so it's not quite as hard.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, because it's not like deer. Like, we've had deer. You can kill, quarter, and cook deer
the same day.
Yeah, like, that's the best backstrap you'll ever have is when you kill, cook right then. Can't do that with a hog.
Mm-mm.
It doesn't work out. Yep. Unless you just like fucking.
What is the backstrap? Because I hear guys, you know, talking about.
It's considered the erector muscle on people. It's what keeps your posture up. Oh, yeah, okay. It's the large main groupings of muscles on either side of the spine that actually cause like tension or movement in the spine.
Yeah.
Because I hear Rogan talking about it all the time.
Oh, it's the best part.
And that's why.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
I've never had it.
I really like it when they cube the meat and they like put it in a stew and it's like cooked over hours and hours. It's like so tender and perfect and all the.
Why are you so low? You're like Barry White all of a sudden.
I don't know.
Did he go straight baritone?
Yeah. He's like, hey, how's it going?
Well, guys, if you notice,
I was up pretty late last night, and then I got home, and then I woke up pretty early still, ate some food, had a really good workout, came straight here pretty much after the shower and
see, I actually like this one a lot better because it's a nice level tone going. I don't have to play with the board much and worry about people's eardrums.
I'm not worried about your job.
I'm
worried about his job. He's the talent. Well, okay.
He could be the talent.
He's so subdued right now. This is really kind of odd.
I know. I need to bring him some crunk juice or something.
No. Leave my Legos alone.
No, but we can get coffee though. I can definitely do coffee.
You should have had me do that before.
Well, I had no idea.
What do you mean you have no idea?
I had no idea that I had to ask before.
Well, because
he's not a mind reader. I'm sorry. He can't just like magically like teleport into your head and say, Selina, "Oh, hey."
That's where I stop you right there on the spot. We're talking 71 episodes in, which means we have done this 71 times.
Yes.
Should just know right now.
Which means he knows it's either crunk juice or coffee.
I didn't know if you were bringing crunk juice.
I had no crunk juice.
So you came in with
I'm being Have. I came in with water.
Oh, whoa, what is that?
Lean impact.
Being Have?
Being Have.
It's fine. Do I need to go downstairs and make you a coffee?
Yeah, man.
I think he's going to whine until such.
I think I like one of those. I mean, I'm fine how I am, but you guys, you know, you're a little dragging right now.
No, if you're fine, then I'm fine.
And but you know, this is probably the level I'm going to be at right here.
I'm good.
This is where I'm living. God damn it. So if you don't like it, I need coffee.
You are one lazy ass producer. Yep. I don't want to play with the buttons.
No, see, my job is right here behind this board.
He's got
right now.
Two jobs, right? The coffee and the
buttons. Yeah, the board, and he doesn't want to do one of them.
He doesn't want to do one of them, and the other one, he just kind of want to like coast that bitch on. Yeah. You know? He's like, yeah, I got a flat, man. We're just gonna coast on down this ramp here, and hopefully we're done. We're done before. Yeah.
Thank you.
Now he goes get Precious the coffee.
I appreciate it.
Then I have to move on my level.
All right, so what other?
He's all red.
That's from the sun.
Oh shit! Yeah. Oh my bad.
So we'll see you when you
put
get
some
back.
Lotions on that.
Puts
the lotions on the skin.
Going back about the deer head.
Oh yeah, what do you do with the deer heads?
What about slop top?
Okay, the deer heads or the pig heads?
Well, he said deer heads. So what do you do? Or let's go with the pig heads.
One of my neighbors pissed me off one time, so I stuck a severed pig head on their doorstep.
Is that illegal or is that like
no, it wasn't. It was totally like they were selling drugs in front of my house when I was living in Murray Hill when it was real hood. Oh, and shit. They just wouldn't leave me the fuck alone. So I got real mad and I ported out some pigs and I walked up to her doorstep and I dropped the pig head on her doorstep because it was her dumb kids that wouldn't leave me alone.
So you had a severed pig head on your neighbor's doorstep.
Yep.
Well, that makes
statutes of limitation have run out anyway.
Sounds legit to me.
I mean, it's a nice way to say, please fuck off and leave me alone.
Did they stop then, huh?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. They wouldn't even walk on the same side of the street anymore.
That's awesome. They're like, I think that's a threat that they're going to shoot me.
I think she's serious and I think she's crazy.
She may shoot me, quarter me, and put my head on my own porch.
You imagine?
Yeah. I just said it.
You could take all that, you know, pig wax and make a head out of it.
Well, see, anytime, like, I dispatch an animal, which is the polite way that we say for killing something, uh-huh. is I try to use or utilize as much of the animal as I possibly can. If I can't, then it winds up being disposed of ethically, or at least the best way that I can obtain ethically, because sometimes you have to kill coyotes because coyotes are going after your friend's livestock and they're killing their livestock. So you have to kill a coyote because they're extremely dangerous animals and they'll kill your friend's pets and everything else.
Mini wolves.
Yeah, we were talking about that last week because there was an article about coyotes evolving and there being like 437 different subspecies now. Mm-hmm.
They are.
It's crazy.
Which one is the pet version?
I would never in a million years want to have one of those mangy things. They carry sarcophagic mange and like type.
I want one without the mange.
Ooh, and good that's luck friendly. With that.
They all have mange.
That's like the equivalent of AIDS.
I think. No, and I remember reading somewhere that they are carriers to it to one degree or another. And I don't know all the specifics behind it, but it was some Field and Stream like article that I read and it was talking about like mange being a really big problem with coyotes because they carry it. So like I'm good.
How do you dispose of the coyotes once you take them out?
If it is an infected animal, usually we wind up having to burn them because we can't let it get in contact with another animal because mange is transmittable after the animal is postmortem. Okay. So you have to kind of worry about stuff like that too.
Damn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No coyotes for you.
Mm-mm.
It's like shooting a dog. But, like, a mean dog.
Yeah, I felt really shitty about it until my friend called me crying because her 3-year-old watched a coyote, like, 2 coyotes, like, rip apart their family dog in front of her, like, 6-year-old.
Oh, God.
So, it was kind of terrible, and she's, like, crying, and she's like, I don't know what to do. And I was like, well, I can do this, but you're probably not going to like it, and you probably should, like, take the girls and, like, not be home for, like, the day, and, like, I'll deal with the coyote situation so you don't have to worry about it again, or at least until, like, they come back. And that was what we wound up doing the last time that we went coyote hunting.
So is this, like, in a country setting, or is this, like, in an urban setting?
I will not deal with any kind of, like, urban animals just because, like, there's pets, there's people, there's kids, you know, somebody's going to wind up calling.
So you got to use a bow and arrow is what you're saying.
No.
So what you're saying, you got to use a big old 308 or something like that, right?
Okay. Out in the country, I use a 308. Just like,
boom, we just see that thing right in half.
Yep. It works.
It didn't even hit the animal. It cut it right in half. Man. That's like a 50 cal. 50 cals will do that. Oof. It can miss you by like 5 inches and it'll just take a big decavitation.
What?
Yeah. It's pretty crazy. I had a buddy, he was a sniper, and he was out, you know what a FOB is? It's like a forward observer base or whatever for the army or whatever. Anyway, so he said that they see these two guys out there like digging a hole and one guy ready to put the thing in there. So like he has that Barrett 50 cal, and he said he shot one, and then he said he shot the other, but it missed him, but it took out like a whole cavity of his side right there. So he died on the spot. That was crazy.
And he didn't hit him.
Didn't even hit him. It was just too close to him. And that the wave.
I've seen the shells from those before, but I've never really like messed with or shot anything like above like a 300 Win Mag. Like that's just really like anything past that. I'm kind of like, I don't know about that.
Thank you, Chris. Look, man, he got me a Starbucks coffee.
Magically
cup.
Appeared with coffee.
I mean, yeah. I don't know why you have Starbucks. I mean,
it was the biggest
bastards,
cup. So anyway,
commie coffee.
Yeah. Have you ever seen the video of the howitzer versus the goat in the room?
Oh, that's amazing, buddy.
There was you're welcome. One of the old tattoo artists that used to work around here, Doran. You know, he was in the army. He was in the armor division. He was telling us one of the training videos they showed was they had a goat in a sealed room, and they would shoot, you know, the film showed they shot a howitzer around the building. Shockwave, and then the vacuum as the round left the
suck
building,
the goat out.
Just boop, and took it through the hole. So
wow,
yeah. So the shock. There's some pretty cool videos you can watch. The shockwaves.
I don't
want
to see that.
Who would like some mutton
right?
for dinner?
Tender,
tenderized,
tender, gutted right from the get go.
I will say, even though I'm a hunter, I'm a big animal person, and that's probably one of the more largest misconceptions with people that do hunt is. People think that you're inherently dangerous, or they think that you don't care about animals or things like that. No, it's actually the polar opposite. I care about the animals enough to the point where I'm invested in their longevity as their species is concerned.
So have you gotten shit from people? Like,
oh my God.
Threats and all that shit?
I have been called a serial killer in training before.
Yep.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Because I like to hunt animals or shoot animals or hurt animals. Like, no. Not really, but okay.
You're like, well, one, they're tasty, and two, the way that our population is growing, they have less area for themselves, and unfortunately, if they outgrow that area and they eat up all the food in the area, it messes the ecosystem, and then they all die from starvation.
You
so.
Have to deal with sustainable wildlife habitation exactly. and population management at that rate, and a lot of people fail to realize that it's not a exact science, but it's a lot of people that have to work together for a large collective goal. And there's people like myself who are invested in that, in a long-term management with the animals.
Yeah, because it ain't cheap to hunt.
No.
Well, until our population gets in control, this is the kind of deal. So, I mean, if you're really, really concerned about people having to go out and kill these animals because of population control, maybe stop having 10 kids.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, stop fucking.
Never going to happen. Or get castrated. That'd be great.
I don't necessarily agree with stop having sex or intercourse or whatever that you want to have, but maybe just like not have the kid part.
Yes, no kids.
some people should not procreate at all.
Yeah. No. Well, I think there was this huge study that came out talking about the people that needs to procreate.
Are
the ones that aren't because they have this like social conscious of what the world is turning into. And the ones that don't really need are having like 6 kids. Like, I was told that I was selfish one time because they're like, oh, you don't want to have a kid? I was like, no. They're like, you're so selfish. I'm like, how am I selfish? Like, I'm looking out for the world. Like, you have 6 kids. Like, how selfish are you?
Because
you want little babies. You want something that looks like you. I was like, and you're not even attractive, so why would the fuck?
I totally get the same shit. Like, people will fuck with me about it, but in my case, like, I can't have kids because I'm a cancer survivor and I had to have a hysterectomy at 28.
Oh wow!
Or excuse me, 26. I always get that fucked up, but I never really wanted kids even prior to that, and that was more of like a conscious choice where I was like, I really don't want to do this, and then I got sick, and then the option was taken away from me, so it just made it a lot easier, but. There's kind of like some weird like social indoctrination that you have to have children in order to be a person.
I can tell you, exactly
what
it is.
You have to get married, you have to have kids, you have to have, you know, these certain things. I was like, I don't believe that's true at all.
No.
It's like the formula of success is derived by that.
No, this is what it is. I'll tell you what it is. It's because everybody's with kids is suffering. They want to bring other people along for the ride with them. They're like,
please
look,
enjoy my suffering too.
If I've got to ride this shit show with you or by myself, I want as many people to come with me as possible.
You know, it's kind of funny because everybody always does tell me those kind of things. They go, dude, I'm telling you right now, you know, you're just happy. Be happy with that. You can just get in your car and go. Like, I can't just do that.
Yes, you can.
I can't. I have to pack the kids and get the diapers and do all this stuff and just be happy you can go to the movies anytime you want. I have to make sure that and I'm like,
well, you made
that
choice.
Yeah, it's because you made the active
choice. That's the thing. But then I was like, well, you know, it's your choice. They're like, but I wouldn't change it for the world. Well, get the fuck out of here. Sounds like you're planning a lot.
No, the thing is the
and you know what? Stop bringing your kids to the movie theaters. I paid $25 to be in the IMAX, man.
Look, I do. I'm not the worst. I'm the worst person to ask about kids. Like friends ask me all the time, man.
You've actually been very straight up and honest.
Yeah, because a lot of people ask me, man, what's it like having kids? You know, I'm thinking about doing it. So, do you want the honest truth, or do you want me to tell you what you want to hear? I'll give you two different options. If you want the honesty, I was like, it is the best and the worst thing that can ever happen to you in your life.
Yeah, I think you talked to me about that.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the thing is that mood swing can happen within 30 seconds. It is a roller coaster ride from the moment you have kids till death. It's just the way it is.
Till death.
Would I change it? I joke around a lot and say, you know, if I could have anything I want a time machine. You know, I always fuck with them like that. But honestly, no, I wouldn't change anything. I love having my kids. It is a complete change of responsibilities and lifestyles and things, because you really do have to change your whole outlook on it's not about what you want to do anymore. It's really about what is best for the entire group.
And I think that's why I don't want any kids. I am selfish. I will admit it. I'm selfish with my time. So,
well, you become more selfish the older you get. And as the kids get older, you start taking back that, you know, okay, I don't have to hold your hand 24/7 now. Mm-hmm. I've got an extra, you know, couple hours a week now that are mine. I'm going to do what the fuck I want. And then you guard those hours hard. Like somebody goes, hey man, you know, instead of going training, you know, why don't we go out to eat? No, I'm going.
Yeah.
I've got 5 hours a week that I can go do whatever the hell I want.
Mm-hmm.
Three of those are, you know, four of those are at the gym.
Out of all the hours in the week, they're all yours. Give me five. I just want five.
Yeah.
Five.
Yeah.
Yeah, just get the fuck out of my way and let me do what the hell I want to do.
So, but then on the flip side, though, it's enjoyable. It's fun. You know, Tyler is the most loving kid you could ever have.
Oh, my God. He's ridiculous. Sure
he you know, sure he is one of the most.
He's a love bug.
He is a love bug. But then on the you really have to learn the quirks and the things of. And then Tegan, on the other hand, she's getting to that age now where it's very – I'm not to the point of saying defiant, but it's more of she's wanting to start doing things her way. And it's like, no.
She's a teen.
Yeah, so. She's become a teen. So it's I'm going through that shit now of, hey, I want to go do this. And I go,
she's testing her boundaries and wanting to see.
It's always the, well, I don't understand why. Because I said no.
Because I hate your face.
Yeah, and then we just – it was funny. She actually –
it's fucking teenage girl bullshit. Like, and it's just going to be, like, moody and weird until she's, like, 20.
It is a little
bit. And then she'll probably apologize and be like, oh, I'm sorry. I'm an asshole.
The funniest thing
– I did to my dad.
Yeah, the funniest thing is me and her actually had a talk up here Thursday. I actually made her late for school. I had to take her to school because I made her miss the bus because she did the walkout. She did. Okay.
John.
Mm-hmm.
Explain the walkout.
So the walkout. Well, all right. So the walkout was.
He's not talking about the walk of shame.
No, it was for the school. No, the school walkout. The school walkout that was to protest the gun violence and changing and reforming of the gun laws. This, that, and the other thing,
which they don't even understand.
So that's Amanda tried to tell her. Amanda actually was kind of off base. She was like, "Look, if you do this, your dad's going to be pissed at you." So then she texted me and she goes, "Hey, I'm doing the walkout. Are you mad?" And I just asked her two questions. I was like, do you know what it's for? Mm-hmm. She goes, yes. I went, okay. Do you want to do it? Or are you being asked to do it? She goes, no, I want to. I went, okay, fine. Then go ahead. We'll talk about it another time. I'm not going to do it over text messages and stuff. So she did her little thing. Next morning, you know, I'm working from home. So I asked her to come up. I'd like to talk to you. And she like come around the corner. She's already getting teary eyed. I'm like, whoa, 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 stop. I was like, I'm not yelling. I'm not mad. Stop. Let's just talk.
Just going to punch you in the face real quick.
No, I asked her. I was like, so tell me what you protested. And I agreed with everything that she protested because she was like, well, I did it because, you know, I want better school security and I want the schools to be safer and things like that. I was like, well, was that how it was presented to you? She goes, yeah. I went, okay. Well, unfortunately, they kind of lied to you. I was like, because that's not what it was about. I said it was about gun rights. And I had to explain the whole Second Amendment. And we got into this deep rabbit hole about it. She was like, well, that's not how it was kind of framed to us. I was like, no, I understand. It's because you're being used as a pawn in a big game that you really don't understand.
Yeah, politics.
Yeah, I was like, so I don't
care
if you...
What's the social injustice thing that people are trying to push around so they can get their way?
Well, this is what fires me up is that the, especially like colleges, and I heard Berkeley was a big abuser of this, is that these students, they have so much school loans and debt and so forth that they get paid to do protests. Like they'll put out advertisement protesting this day, so they don't even know what to protest, and they're out there doing crazy shit. And but they're like, they'll bus them in and they'll protest at whatever that college is, and they'll be like, well, there's over 800 people protesting so and so forth, whatever it may be. So I had no idea about that until, you know, some guys, you know, from these big colleges told me, like, yeah, that's a normal thing. That's like what they do. I'm like, what? Really?
Yeah, I've heard some of my clients talk about it in past, and they're like, yeah, I might not necessarily agree with it, but they make money.
Yeah, they get paid. Yeah. You know, that's how they pay for their books, that's how they do these things. So,
or somebody is like their big brother or something, like takes over like the lab fees or something for the year, like, and that shit gets expensive.
Oh yeah. Well, the biggest thing is you had your hometown, Detroit. Okay, they're having, I shouldn't say your hometown, but one of the places you grew up. Okay, they're having issues keeping the schools heated through the winter, and you know, they have a real lack of funding. But they just spent $150,000 to bus kids to D.C. to protest.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So there's some priority issues here. You know, you can't keep schools warm, but you just found $100,000 or $150,000 to bus kids to a protest.
Where the fuck did that money come from?
Kind of thing. But so me and Tegan, we talked about it and we, you know, did our thing. And I told her, I have no issues with you protesting something. If you want to protest something, knock yourself out. I was like, but you better understand you need to educate yourself on what it is you're protesting, and you better be able to stand up and defend your point, because I'm not just going to let you protest whatever you want, or, you know, if you have a stance on something, great, but you better be able to defend that stance, and you have to be open to defending that stance, because if not, not worth it.
What I think is important, and I've heard this from a couple different sources, is that you should be able to argue your opponent's side better than they can argue it if you're going to pick a side.
Yes.
Yep.
So if your like stance is this one thing right here, you need to be able to go over there, switch shoes, and argue against yourself. And if you argue against yourself and you can beat your own self,
then your argument has holes.
Your argument has holes, and you need to probably really think and deliberate on what you actually believe and what you actually want.
But see, that's rational.
But if you don't go over there and argue against yourself, you know, or at least pull up the points, the main points, you're really ill-equipped, because you don't even know how to respond. They're going to say something and you're like, oh yeah, and it's going to turn into you're a Nazi.
No, that's super easy. And the thing is a lot of people, unfortunately, nowadays,
easy for younger generation individuals to just point the, hey, you're a Nazi because you disagree with something that I have to say.
Yeah. Or something to that degree. You know what I mean? They just go to this crazy side. It doesn't matter if it's left or right, but it gets
vehement on both sides.
Yeah, it's so terrible. I'm thinking to myself, man, do you know what the Nazis really did? And you're calling that person a Nazi, or you're calling this person or whatever?
Or like when people try to uphold communism as being like a good thing, or socialism being a good thing, and it's like,
did you not go to school?
Yeah, did you not go to school, and have you ever been outside the United States? Like, do you actually understand?
They just didn't do socialism right. It's never socialism and communism's never been done right.
Socialism and communism are idealistic forms of what humanity should be.
But that's the argument that you'll always hear when you start talking about it.
Oh, forever and always.
Yeah, it just hasn't been done right.
It's just not what drives people. That's not what drives people. If they don't have to do something, they're not going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
They won't. Like, even myself, like, I had to write up Junior Sailor of the Quarter package for somebody, and I could have continually put it off until my chief emailed me. It was like, I need this today. I'm yeah. like, oh, shit. Well, I was going to do it this weekend. You know, like, I didn't have to do it.
Moved up the priority list.
I could have done it 3 days previous, but I mean, I was busy and all that stuff. It was like, you know what I mean? So, like, when it comes to work, like, if I don't have to do that extra bit because I get paid the same as that guy and that guy and that guy, you know what I mean? I'm using pretty general terms here, but do you get what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. I'm not going to do that extra just because I'm self-motivated. People aren't generally self-motivated. Mm-hmm. Those are the 5%ers, the 1%ers, the 2%ers that are really at the top that are self-motivated. You got your Will Smiths, you got your
Joe Rogans,
your Dwayne Johnsons, your Jocko Willink. Those guys are really self-motivated people, but the average person isn't. Your Goggins. Oh my God, that fucking guy.
Well, the thing is it is a lot of people have the whole misconception that, you know, you're either just self-motivated or you're not self-motivated. You're right. either like born with it or you're not born with it. And it's like, guess what? That's not the case, because for every self-motivated person, if they're honest with you, they'll tell you it's one of the hardest things to do.
Sometimes I am. Sometimes I'm not.
And that's the thing. Sometimes you have to be – you have to understand that it's going to come and go. Yeah. You know, you're not
– Yeah, it definitely comes in waves, because like, I got really lucky when I started working with Nick, and he definitely taught me a hell of a lot about being a self-motivation, like, mindset and how to be concise and how to be organized and make sure that you set deadlines to make sure that things are getting done. And he has continued to push that onto me the longer that I work for him. And now I'm coming up on 7 years working with him, and I have never, ever been this productive. I was not this productive when I started working for
him. No, the way y'all keep your schedule in your books, and that's the thing that I try to explain to people. They're like, oh, man, I'm thinking about getting a tattoo. I'm going to go swing in and go talk to him and get a tattoo.
That's cute.
Yeah, that's not how that works. Good luck, but that's not how it works.
We remind people every week on the podcast, get on that newsletter, because if you're not on that newsletter – you're not going to know when the times are going to be opening up.
You will not be able to just walk in and come talk to me or Nick or Soleil or anything like that.
Self-righteous or anything like that. It's just that there's so many people. That's the only way to keep it organized.
Dude, y'all are booked up.
Not even that. A lot of it has to do with, if somebody's paying me the time and they have waited, I want to make sure that I can dedicate that time and that patience and give them every ounce of my attention. And there's nobody else impacting that whatsoever. So once that person gets in my chair and I'm working on like this horribly involved cover up because this person, you know, was a dumb teenager and got some really stupid tattoos and now I need to cover them. Well, they've waited a year or so to get tattooed by me because it takes that long as far as like a process because of how many people try to get tattooed by us. So it's a little bit of firefighting and like management there. But, you know, I don't want people coming in and trying to ask me questions when I'm trying to work and draw on this person and try to figure out an entire sleeve in the course of however long it takes. Yeah. So,
because not a lot of people understand, like most tattoo shops, you'll have a guy, they'll be working, they'll be tattooing somebody. You can walk up and you can ask them questions. You can talk to them while they're doing somebody's tattoo, you know.
That seems rude, though.
It does seem rude, but that is just walk-in shop style. Now, at Black Hive, half the time, if there's a tattoo going on, the doors are closed. Or if they're not closed, because I've just learned from being respectful. When I come walking in, I look, and if they acknowledge me, then I say hey or something like that. If not, I keep moving, and I go to where I'm supposed to go, normally Nick's room. You don't fuck with the people because they're working on that person at that time.
It's work.
Who's booked 3 hours of their time and who's paying a premium, you know, that's why when their books open, motherfuckers are flocking. And
you know, I just opened my books and I had 20 slots open and I got 278 submissions in like 6 days.
Yeah. And for the guy who did not read the newsletter and, and sent the email that night. Yeah. You're not getting in because he didn't read.
Yeah. We have an auto reply set up for all that kind of stuff. And we have a shop manager that helps kind of like deal with everything. And
I read his email and it was shitty from the get go. He's like, hey, I want to get a tattoo.
Okay.
Oh, you should see some of the shit that I get.
I me and Nick, since we didn't tattoo the other night.
I want the dragon, but you know where.
Yeah. No.
Yeah, that's $5,000 right there.
Have you ever been asked to tattoo that area?
Oh, yeah. And I charge an asinine amount of money for it because it just... Listen, you expect me to be that close? Guess what? You gonna pay, motherfucker.
Yep. I mean, money's money. They'll do it. But you are gonna pay.
You gonna pay for my time?
Like I've got one tattoo that's been done by Nick that he won't do on anybody else, period.
Tank. The one in the penis?
It's believe it or not, it's actually the simplest one.
You know, watching somebody get that fucking done is pretty fucking terrible, I might say.
Oh,
that a tattoo convention and I had to watch
that
it.
That one?
Oh.
That's the only one I've got that he'll never do again.
What?
The ring.
Oh, the finger. Oh, okay. Oh God. Fingers are so terrible to tattoo and they hurt so fucking bad.
And he told me when he did it. He was like, don't tell people I do them because if they come to my shop and ask me to do them, I'm telling them to fuck off. Plain and simple. Because one, they don't heal good. Even if they do heal good, they're only going to last maybe 6 months before they start getting blown out.
Yeah.
You know, and I knew it, but the jobs I had and stuff, I can't wear rings. So I was like, I just want to do it. And yeah, out of all the tattoos I have on my body, that one sucked the most. Really? Out of all of them, that one sucked the absolute most.
What's the worst what's the worst part to tattoo that people mostly complain about that says, oh my God, that hurts?
Ribs.
So bad.
Yeah.
Ribs and feet. Ribs and feet.
Ribs down here is okay. This shit up here, though?
Yeah,
that is a special kind of hell.
Yeah, that's
on, like, the top. Yeah. Listen, like, man, on the top of the rib cage. Like, that's fucking terrible. You know what else
sternum?
Hurts worse than that?
Sternum was fucking
underneath the butt cheek on the back of the thigh. That is god-awful.
I don't know. Yeah. I haven't done that.
Amanda did that.
It's so bad.
On the butt cheek?
Yeah, it's fucking terrible. It feels like a steak knife being, like, drugged through your flesh.
Have you
it's
never
awful.
Seen
I don't have tattoos.
No, but, I mean, have you never seen Amanda's tattoo?
No, I'm not looking at her.
Your wife doesn't exactly walk around naked.
No, she doesn't. But, I mean, it literally goes from her neck down to the bottom of her knee.
Yeah, that's what mine does.
Bro, I'm not
too.
Checking out your wife.
I don't understand. But you'd be surprised how many people come.
Listen,
is that a cat tail?
Not saying your wife's not attractive, but I'm not looking at your wife.
Oh, I know, but you should see. I mean, her whole ass, like both cheeks and everything.
You should see it, man. You should see it, man. I'll tell you what. Hey, Amanda, get your pants up here. Take
the
pants off. Turn around.
Take pants off.
I'm sorry.
It's for show purposes.
Yeah.
And Callahan, this is more acceptable. I understand you guys are prudes and shit.
Well, you can
look at this tattoo.
You can see it in her shorts and shit like that.
All right, Ricky Bobby.
Yeah.
No, we're in Callahan now. God damn it.
I think
no
that
Ricky
tattoo
Bobby
is
one.
Just for you, bro.
No, it's not.
Yeah.
Because you can see it at the beach, and literally you have the people come up and be like, is that a cat? Does it
look
like a fucking cat?
I totally had an old lady ask one time when I was walking around in a bikini down in Jack's Beach, and I was just hanging out with some of my friends from, like, they had come over from London.
What's that going to look at, like, when you're 90? Like, I don't give a fuck what it looks like when I'm 90.
I don't have eyes
in the
back of my head.
I'm going to be really fun to look at when I'm old.
Yeah.
I'm going to be really fun, but we were walking around, and I'm wearing, like, a black bikini, and, like, a part of the tail was, like, hanging out from the snake on my back, and this little old lady very, very sweetly, innocently asked, like, honey, is that tattooed everywhere? It's like, yes, ma'am, it is.
Those are the people I enjoy. I've learned that there's a real fine window, and it seems to be the age group that I'm in right now are the most judgmental, assholish people about tattoos.
Oh,
and then once you get up to, like, the 60, 70-year-old people, they enjoy them. They're fun. They like them. And the kids like them. Because I've had kids, like, been standing in the bank and you'll all of a sudden you feel something tracing on your leg. Mm-hmm. What the fuck? And there's a little kid literally sitting there like tracing your tattoo. And I'm like, normally I would be like, yo, don't fucking touch me. But this is just an innocent
kid.
But now granted, his mom snatched him up and be like, you know, we don't talk to people like that. I'm like, cool, whatever.
I usually stay pretty well covered up most of the time. So, like, I have the tattoos on my neck and on my face and stuff that you can see. But if I have my hair down and I'm wearing a long sleeve shirt, for the most part, you can pretty much kind of, like, look past me unless, like, you do a double take and it's like, oh, shit, her face is tattooed.
Yeah.
But most of the time, like, if I'm out walking around in, like, a tank top or something, somebody will come up to me and somebody will want to talk to me. As long as nobody touches me,
we're good.
We're fine. But if somebody touches me,
then their head comes off and gets dropped off.
I'll freak out.
So I got a quick question. So like, yeah, you do have face tattoos. Like, when I look at you, I don't even really notice them anymore.
No.
Yeah.
But, like, I just don't. I'm like, oh, hey, Selina, how you doing, honey? Give me a hug.
Yeah.
But like underneath the neck there, that had been a fun situation, right?
It was really not bad to get it tattooed. I get a lot of really dumbass questions about it all the time, and people always want to come up to me and try to touch it or, like, look at it, like, especially if I'm at, like, a bar or something.
Yeah.
Somebody will want to try to, like, touch it because they think it's fake because you don't see people with tattoos right there.
Yeah.
And I have the rest of my neck that's going to be done. So, I mean, everything will be done eventually at a point whenever I stop being a little bitch about getting my neck tattooed because fuck. Ow. But I don't really think about it anymore. So
does it bother? Okay. It bothers me. So I'm pretty sure it bothers you. But have you seen these mumble rappers getting, like, these crazy tattoos on their face?
Oh my god. Oh, you hit a nerve.
Yeah.
Well, motherfucker, don't get your goddamn face tattooed unless you got some other shit done.
Didn't one of them die?
Which pick one?
What, Gucci Man or some shit with the fucking ice cream cone on his face?
Yeah, I think he died. Yeah, he had the guy. What's crazy is he had the ice cream cone.
Wasn't Little Bo Peep or something like that?
But then he had, which was supposed to be lightning bolts, but if you didn't know that they were supposed to be lightning bolts, they looked like the SS.
Oh, my God. Why?
Dude.
Whoa.
Yeah.
You're an awesome.
Didn't really think that one through.
That's real counterproductive there, buddy.
You know they don't like you.
I still got people. They'll still come up and grab my arm or something like that. Be like, is that Street Fighter? I'm like, dude, why are you grabbing my arm? Just, you can be like, hey, walk up. Hey, is that Street Fighter? Like, yeah.
I will lose my shit if somebody touches me. I'm such a fucking germaphobe. Like, it's not even funny. Get away from me.
Has anybody ever approached you about the gun fishing one?
Yes, that one actually gets a lot of questions. People, when they see my arms, they go, because a lot of times, like, if I'm always riding with my hand like this, they'll see the, you know, be back later. And then they'll be like, well, what does that mean? And then I'll just kind of hold the other one up. And they go, oh, shit, that is funny. I was like, cool, thanks. Yeah, I appreciate it. I've got
Chris is well adorned with very funny tattoos.
Yeah, I've got fun ones, you know. I've got that one. I've got the name tag on the back of my leg.
Just in case you ever forget it.
No, actually, the whole reason why I got it done is
his leg is blown off.
When I was an electrician, I used to get tired of being called Sparky all the time.
Sparky? Seriously?
Yeah, that's what they called me all the time, was Sparky, because I was an electrician. And since I'm always up on a ladder, I was always at like that head high. So me and Chance were actually sitting around goofing off, and we were like, I just need to get a name tag tattooed on me. And he was like, bro, drew one up real quick. Slapped it on. He was like, let's do it. I was like, cool. Looks good. Even got the little pieces of tape on each opposite corner. So it looks like it's taped to my leg.
So you have Chris on your leg.
Yeah. I said, hello, my name. It says, hello, my name is. And then Chris. And then right underneath it, I got the.
Which is so terribly like fitting for your personality.
It is. It is. And then which underneath has the IH8U, which stands for I hate you. So it's like, you know, hello, my name is Chris. I hate you. And then I've got the robot that I got by, who was Nick's apprentice about 5 years ago? Remember the dude with the beard? You remember him?
5 years ago.
Five or six.
Honey, no. He hasn't had an apprentice since I've been there. No, I've been there 7 years.
No, okay. Well, then it's had to been
10 years.
10, maybe.
Yeah, I don't know who that is. I wasn't around.
He's only been there 7?
No, we were actually talking about it. He's been at that location now going on 10 years, okay. Which is hard to believe because we were sitting in his.
I've been getting tattooed by him for 8, almost 9 years now.
I'm going on 16, I think, being tattooed by Nick. 16, holy I think shit. You're going on what, 18?
Yeah, it's been a long time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so.
I have some OG status.
Yeah.
Nick is our buddy.
Yeah, I'm actually, the next one's on the Achilles tendon for me. Yeah.
It's actually not.
Are you dumb?
It's actually not that bad.
I think you're dumb.
It's the Gucci one, though. It's for
Gucci. Oh. Yeah, so. that's
But to answer your question, he's dumb as
shit. Yeah, I'm dumb as shit.
Oh, he totally is. I know he is. Yeah.
Selina knows me. She knows I'm dumb as shit.
The Achilles isn't that bad.
I hope not.
It's not. It really isn't. I mean, you know what I was kind of freaked out about? Well, so like I was having my calves done, so he knocked on my calves, and he was like, hey, man, I'll do a free stinger for you on the top of your foot, like a big old fucking fat black hive. But like I'm telling
that's
you,
that's the only tattoo I fucking cried on was my foot.
I was done on the back of the calf. That was like 5 or 6 hours right there, or maybe it was like 4.5, 5 hours. But I was done. I was like, I felt my body kind of like going into its, you know, the shock mode. Mm-hmm. Like getting tattooed to me isn't really that bad, but afterwards I feel myself like going through the shock mode. Like
mm-hmm. My body's like, pussy to get tattooed.
Yo, what the fuck did you do? And why did you sit there for that long?
It almost feels like you have the flu and like you run like a low grade temp and like everything is just super fucking weird.
Get achy, little
and then you're tired and you're really hungry and you're really grouchy.
You sleep.
That's him every day.
Yeah, but bam, that night of
he's
sleep.
He's perpetually running on E every day. Like, are you
I
kidding?
Know.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah. He doesn't eat enough. Well, I definitely don't eat it.
Are you in a cut? Is that what you're doing right now? Is that why you're not eating right?
No, he doesn't have time or he doesn't think about
most
it.
Most of the time I don't have time.
Oh my God.
I juggle so many crazy things. Like, and that, actually, that's why I'm so happy that I have Wallow handling my social media for me is because like literally between
it's
all the
lot.
Jobs that I do and teaching and everything else that I can't handle it all. Like he handles all the content. He handles all the tags and gets things pushed. And you know, he's about to get his own budget or whatever, where he can do his marketing part. It's just that.
Hit me up. I'll share some shit with you.
Yeah, I've been doing a lot.
Most definitely do that. But before, when I was doing it all by myself for like over a year, like
it's exhausting.
People are like, "Why are you always on your phone?" I'm like, "Well, I'm answering messages all the time." You know what I mean? I was like, "There has to be a more efficient way," but I'm the only one who can do it properly.
Honestly, Leek, you have to set parameters and like guidelines for like when you'll actually respond to that kind of stuff. Like, yeah. I have hard time limits for when I work on the APT stuff, which is the Alliance of Professional Tattooers, and then when like I'll respond to stuff regarding like my documentary, or I'll respond to stuff that's regarding the shop, or I'll just respond for like personal stuff.
So what's the documentary on?
I'm doing a documentary on the history of female tattoo artists is what I'm doing.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. When did you start doing that?
That has been in progress for about a year, and fuck, man, let me tell you, the amount of work that goes into doing a documentary is insane. I had to hire production team and film crew and audio people, and then also have to deal with like entertainment lawyers and stuff, because like you get into like really weird gray area about what you can and can't do and like what you can and can't say like on film. And then, you know, we're trying to keep it a true nonprofit, and I teamed up with the Alliance of Professional Tattooers because they wanted me to deal with the social media marketing and administration of that. And that's taken a little while to kind of get that off the ground because of how much stuff is involved with the APT itself. But I think we're going to wind up changing gears a little bit with the documentary itself. Mothers of Tattooing is what we're working on. And put that underneath the APT so that it's strictly like an educational standpoint. And we're doing more like archival data and just taking like interviews from like profound female tattooers and other tattooers in general.
How far back does your research go?
The earliest research that I have gotten in my hands is about 1890 is where we're sitting right now.
Wow.
And that was from a tattooer named Maud, M-A-U-D-E. One of the gals that I'm on the board membership with for the APT is a huge theology nut, and is also very, very, very big into sociology. And she, I can't remember exactly what she studied, and where she kind of went with everything, but her background is education before she became a tattooer. And so she's been involved with like college systems and teaching and administrative and things like that. She actually, started collecting a lot of data regarding like the history of female tattooers years ago. And it really has never been put into publication or really utilized. And she offered to basically turn a lot of that stuff over to me to make my job a little bit easier when I start going through the process of dealing with the documentary. So I've got access to a lot of really good information that way.
That's awesome. Nice. Mm-hmm. How long have you been tattooing?
16 years.
Is that something that you've always done, or did you have a different job before?
Okay, so I'm 32, and I started working when I was 12. I have been working on and off literally most of my life, because I found gratification in saying, okay, I can work and I can buy what I want,
right,
and I can do what I want when I want to do it. So the first job I had, I was actually a carny.
Yeah. Yo, I can see
Chris,
that.
Chris is laughing because he knows about this story, because it's really funny.
That's why I told you. I was
she smells like cabbage.
Before even the convention stuff, I was like, yo, we need to get Selina in here. Y'all can have some fun and hear some good stories.
I've done some crazy shit. So I used to do like the strongman bell, and then like the sand art booth and cotton candy. And like, I used to work with like the little kids, like pony rides and shit like that. And I've shoveled horse shit, and I've messed with elephants before, camels, you name it. If it's like carnival related type stuff, it was something that I did. And, the guy that used to live across the street from my childhood neighborhood, he actually started a carnival from his house. And it was back before like bluegrass fairs was really like a big thing. Bluegrass is now like all the fairs that are down here, like in the Southeast.
The county fairs.
Yeah. County fairs and stuff like that. And, he had like these, sand art booths and like bounce houses. So in the summer, I would literally go with him to like the shrimp festival, or like the spring and the blues festivals, or like any of them, and go work, because like I go out there and I go watch the booth and I go do some sand art. He pays me $50 for a day. And that's a lot of money when I was like 12 years old.
Yeah.
So I just started doing that. And that was how I would buy like art supplies and, you know, pretty much anything else. And then I
did. So you've always liked drawing and stuff like
that? Oh yeah. I've been drawing since I was like 3 years old.
Oh wow.
Yeah. That's been like the pinnacle. Like, that's always kind of like how I keep myself sane. It's how I keep myself in check. Like, this is a creative medium that I use to express myself. This is, it's a release. It's something that I find a lot of, I'm competitive with myself to try to push myself to get better daily. And I'm always trying something new, or I'm trying to come up with like a new composition or create something different. And it's always just kind of like a constant manipulation and like messing with it. So
how do you transition from drawing to tattooing? Because there's a lot of people out there that are great artists, but
You can be the best artist in the fucking world, but unless you have like a decent aptitude of medical knowledge, you understand the mechanics of the human body and the way the human body works, you have at least a base understanding of like human psychology, because you really have to get somebody through something incredibly fucking painful in order to finish the tattoo so that you get paid. And as well as getting somebody past a point where they kind of remit control over what they think in their head is how a tattoo should work, when in actuality, that's not really how it works. So you have to kind of like talk them through that entire process. And there's a whole plethora of shit that gets involved with that. You have to be a germ Nazi, like above and beyond by anything. Well, I mean, we're actually required by the state to actually take bloodborne pathogen licenses now, but back in the years when I first started, that wasn't a thing. We didn't have to study that kind of shit. Now, luckily, the guy that taught me how to tattoo, he was very good about that kind of stuff, and he taught me a great deal, so it became second nature for me. And there's a lot of weird nuances with tattooing. Tattooing is kind of counterculture. Tattooing is very weird. It's way more accepted now, but it hasn't always been like that.
Yeah, did you see the big story that was this week about, or I think it's the story that's been running a little bit, but tattoos are in, neckties are out. Mm-hmm. You know, that the tattoos, the culture of having tattoos and stuff is starting to get up into, you know, management and upper management levels, and it's starting to be a little bit more accepted. Because, you know, even at my company, when I first started, I was always kind of under the impression I was always be a field guy. You know, I've got tattoos. I had the big earrings at one point. It's like, I'm always going to be a field guy, so whatever, it doesn't matter.
You had the
Yeah, I had the big gauges.
The big girl.
Yep.
What is it? The hoops.
No, I had
cholo hoops. I'm wearing a set right now.
Yeah. No, I was.
Piercings
I got
things there for chicks.
I stretched mine out to the point where I could slide 45s into my ears and stuff like that.
Damn, 000 there, buddy.
Mm-hmm. That's pretty cool. Yeah. Though. I mean, I see you guys. Well, I think, you know, guys that do the stretches or whatever, you know, that's very like, yeah, a unique look that you're very specific.
It's a primitive tribal ethic ritual from Africa, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah,
but, it was
but
fun.
Like normal, like eyebrow piercings and nose piercings, I'm kind
of
like,
A lot of that stuff actually originates from like some type of Aboriginal or like Native American culture or some kind of variety thereof. A lot of that stuff has roots within like tribal rituals with Africa.
Yeah, and but when you got Chad doing it, it's kind of like,
I agree, but it was something that became like a thing that came in the 90s, and people thought that it was cool and edgy, and then it started becoming more trendy, and more people started getting it and doing it.
Yeah, there unfortunately, there's a reason why Black Hive doesn't have a piercer.
Yeah, the shit that comes with piercing is a whole different ball game and a whole different ball of wax.
Yeah, and that was ruined years ago by somebody with Nick. Back
I remember that.
I remember that story.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, tell the story.
No, I don't want to tell the story.
We can't really say that one. He has to say that. Because
yeah, that's a Nick thing. That's a Nick thing. But it was just the same thing, like what she said. Just normally the people that you deal with and the mentalities that you deal with.
I can tell a story about piercing. The last time I had to deal with it.
Okay.
So I'm a very nice person as compared to where I used to be. I used to be a fucking cunt. We'll just say it that way. I was an asshole. I was not nice, and I was really mean, and I was pissed off all the fucking time.
What changed?
Nick.
Oh. Wait, the guy that used to headbutt people for fun
calmed me down. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
He basically just out-assholed her.
That's exactly what happened. He's like, you are not the asshole anymore. Stop it. And I was also a hormonal fucking wreck, too, because, like I said, like with like the cancer shit and everything else. And then, like, I was dealing with like the demise of my previous marriage. And like, I just had like so much at one time. And then the environment that I worked in was kind of like in the hood, and it was kind of terrible. And it was just fucked up most of the time. But we had this girl,
103rd hood,
103rd and Blanding.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, it was the week before I left. there was a hostage situation in the check cashing place on the same corner as where my shop was. Yep. I mean, it was real. But I had this girl. She came in. Mama. She wanted a $10 tongue ring. Well, I had just gotten done tattooing. And I was like, hey, just give me a minute. I'll take my gloves off and I'll sell you a tongue ring. Well, apparently I wasn't moving fast enough for her. And we'll just go ahead and say I was a real big girl back then. Like, we're talking like 400 pounds big girl. And
really? Yeah, she's done a lot of work over the last 2 years, 3 years.
Yeah. You go, girl. So I'm like, all right, whatever. Like, give me a second. Give me a second. Give me a second. Well, I just was not moving fast enough and I had to take my gloves off. And she screamed at me, you fat fucking bitch. You can't even get off your fat ass to sell me a tongue ring. And it was like, ding, ding, ding. Bells on. All right. I'm ready to fight.
Round one.
I chased her out of the front of the tattoo shop with a baseball bat and I attacked her in the car.
Oh, yeah. Allegedly. Damn. Allegedly. Wait, allegedly.
Yeah. Was this over 7 years ago?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
7 or 8 years ago. It's been a little while. Statute of limitation. You can't fucking do anything now. Maybe, this is why I'm saying this.
Maybe it happened. Who knows? Is that why OG's so, telling people that he murdered that chick finally? Because
probably. Statute of limitation winds up being
run
up.
You'd be double jeopardy, so.
Yeah. Or some bullshit. The body piercer was also pissed off, but she was pregnant at the time. And so she was hormonal and fucking mad. I was hormonal and fucking mad. And this girl, like, popped off the mouth at me. And I was just like, oh, hell no. I done had enough of you motherfuckers over here on the goddamn hood. And I just walked straight the fuck out the front door.
Shit.
And took a baseball bat to the hood of her car. And the body piercer was standing on the hood of her car trying to kick in the windshield. So.
Wow. Man.
That's 103rd
scene right there, man.
You motherfuckers better be in line when you go to Black Hive.
No,
we're nice now.
Yeah. That was that was the reason why, like, literally before me and Amanda had kids and stuff like that, we literally kind of grew up in Nick's tattoo shop or the Northside tattoo shop was because there's always some shit going on.
Yeah.
Always. Between that, and you're going to have some of the best conversations with people you'll ever fucking have with tattoo artists.
You will totally meet, like, some of the most, like, interesting and, like, and interesting and smart people who will actually carry on a conversation and force you to think of things that you may not have ordinarily thought about. So, which is kind of cool. And Nick has been fantastic for getting me to slow the fuck down and actually think about what I'm doing or how I'm like interacting with people. And I have mellowed out so much more by working around him. And he has definitely set the tone and the pace for the way that things work.
Which is so fucking weird compared to what me and Art knew of Nick 15 mm-hmm. years ago.
Yeah, you told me he was headbutting people for fun.
Dude, he'd headbutt people. He'd monkey bite you.
Well, listen, man, I have a different.
Yeah, he's super nice to you.
For me and Nick, man, like, I've never seen him get crazy or headbutt or monkey bite or anything like that. But we always had like this a different kind of respect level for each other. I think it's I don't fuck around like that. Like, don't mm-hmm. fucking touch me like that. But also, too, like, you know, he didn't like me when he first met me because I was, like, a muscle head, you know. It was before I did martial arts and all that stuff. I just lived a lot of weights. And
you were a pretty boy, too.
According to him, I was a pretty boy. So he just thought I was.
Well, you were a model, so.
Back in the day. But, yeah, he used to. I was this dick, you know, and then I was going to be rude or whatever. And then, like, a couple tattoo sessions in, he's like, dude, I'm so sorry. I misjudged you. You're like, you're fucking awesome. I'm like, thanks, man. So he's like, people do that to me all the time, and I can't believe I just did that to you. I apologize. I was like, well, fucking cool. So I railed that into him for about 10 years. I'm like, hey, remember that time he thought I was a dick?
asshole. He told the story on the show.
I got to tell the story about how he wound up hiring me. So.
Oh, yeah.
Nick did not want to hire me because he was too worried about my personality being too strong and us being abrasive with each other in the tattoo shop.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So. I actually got the balls and straight asked him. I was like, well, if you're not going to hire me, I want to know why. And he was like, what the fuck? Like, you actually want to know? Like, because nobody had ever asked him before. They had asked for a job, like, they had always taken the rejection and, like, bowed out gracefully. And I wanted to go toe-to-toe, and I wanted to know why.
I'm going to fight.
No.
I'm going to take it back to the hood of your car, motherfucker.
I was pretty angry at that time, too, but I was just more of like, I need a fucking way out because I need to do something better with my life because I felt like I was just like wasting away and like potential and like opportunity.
Is that what was making you angry?
Yeah. Between that and like my ex-husband being kind of a shitbag and like the guy that I used to work for, he was kind of being a little bit of a shitbag at that time. We were not getting along at all. And I was trying to find like the next evolution. And I felt like I was just hitting a wall because at that point I'd been tattooing for about 9 years and I worked in the same spot. And I was just like, there needs to be more. Like, I feel like my life is not where it should be. I feel like I need to take that next step. And I just posed it to Nick as a question, like, I don't really know where to go with my career here at this point. And I need to talk to somebody who's better than me, who has been some of the places that I want to go, because I don't know what I'm doing here. And at the time, the guy that I was working for, he was pissed off at me about something regarding a computer. And I was getting like fucked up text messages while I'm like at this major tattoo convention. And I was just like, you know what? These other people that I'm standing next to who are the same class of artist as I am, if not better, are not even remotely worried about anything. And here I am worried about my boss back home in Jacksonville. And I'm at a tattoo convention where there's like 50,000 people in attendance. Like, what am I doing here? Like, I'm fucking missing something. So I got home, and I was already in the process of having a back piece started by Nick, and I just cold shot asked him. I was like, are you looking for another artist? Like, I need something. And he was like, no, and just gave me this very gruff look. And now I know, Nick, you can never ask him something kind of cold shot like that and expect it to come out or turn out well. And he was just not really interested, but he still agreed to talk to me. So the next day I went in and sat down and talked with him, and I was like, listen, I understand that you don't want to hire me, but can I ask why? So I can try to get a better job somewhere else, because I feel like I'm limited to the potential that I can have at the place that I'm at now. And I just don't really know what to do. And he didn't know that I was in the middle of a divorce at the time. And there was like a lot of other things that were kind of like going on. And I was just getting out of being very sick. And I was starting to try to make better, smarter, healthier choices in my life to start losing weight and start taking better care of myself and being a little bit more invested in myself. So it was like all of those things, like all in one time. And he was like, I'll think about it, but I think that we're going to wind up having a problem and this and that. I was like, well, you know, I have a lot of personality. I'm really strong-willed with a lot of different things, but I was raised by a single parent, and my dad was a senior chief, and my dad was also a chief warrant officer. So, you know, you throw those couple things, plus being a Vietnam vet, raising a single parent, raising a teenage daughter in the hood on top of that. Yeah, I'm going to be a little bit fucking crazy. I'm not everybody's cup of tea. But that's fine. And after I sat down and really kind of like had the conversation with Nick, he kind of thought about it a little bit more. And I think it took about 3 days. And if I'm not mistaken, he talked to you about it too, didn't he, Chris?
Yeah.
Because, you know, nobody really knew me around the shop. Like, I was strictly a client. Nick did not know me otherwise.
Yeah, we had we sat down, had sushi, and, you know, we laid everything out, laid pros, laid cons. Look through her portfolio, what her work, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And I just kind of gave him my opinion.
Besides thinking that she was abrasive and that they were going to clash, what were the other cons?
The cons,
being young, just getting over being really sick, like that was a big thing too.
Unfortunately, too, in, you know, that's probably she'll touch on in her documentary. Unfortunately, in the tattoo world, at least back then, you know, girls weren't looked at as
highly
as they are now. And you always had the thing, there would always maybe be some issues with some or this, that. It seemed like drama sometimes came. So shop owners were always real hesitant about trying to invite that into
having women artists.
Yeah, because they just don't want that. You know, they think it's going to be a big deal. And then after talking about, you know, with Nick and he explaining about how Selina was and stuff like that, I was like, bro, I don't think you're going to have that kind of a problem.
But if the portfolio looks good, what the fuck's the difference?
Well, because
there's a lot of difference with that. We spend more time at work than most people do at home. Yeah. You know, I spend 10 to 12 hours a day at the tattoo shop. Mm-hmm. I see them more than I see a significant other or anybody else that I have in my life. And if the personalities don't clash, if the personalities clash, there's going to be a problem.
Yeah, because there's going to be a problem. You've got nowhere to go. You're in your cubicle.
You can't get away from each other.
Yeah, you're working side by side.
Everybody
all day
has
long.
To mesh together. Everybody's got to kind of have a degree of respect for each other. I mean, yeah, there can be horseplay. Yeah, there can be fucking off. But going from working in a shop where the owner was not so concerned about the personalities and the way that people mesh together, as opposed to being with somebody that actually works like that, it's a lot better to actually be focused on that kind of mindset. And I notice a very stark difference in working with Nick, because now I take a lot of those things into consideration when I'm trying to help him around the shop, because I deal with some of the management aspect on certain things. And, you know, I've helped run a tattoo shop before, and sometimes Nick just wants a sounding board, mm-hmm. and he can come talk to me about a lot of that stuff so we can have a good conversation. Nick and I have become very good friends only after me working there. We never had any other kind of interaction before that.
Besides so, just being a client.
Yeah, just being a client, and, you know, he really didn't know me until he took the time to actually invest in me and saw a great deal of potential, and I was interested in learning. And I also have that same weird, quirky mindset that he does of, like, constantly trying to improve. And he wasn't really used to having somebody working around him like that, who is as hungry for that type of detail and that type of, like, mindset, and would constantly ask questions and pick at him.
So the fact that you were a female artist did not play a role in him making that decision of hiring you?
No. Luckily, Nick is one of those guys. He is really equal. Yeah. When it comes mm-hmm. to stuff like that, it's either your shit's good or your shit's not good.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Do you think a lot of tattoo shops are the same way? Or
no. No, absolutely not.
No.
Not everybody's run like that.
Unfortunately, a lot of tattoo shops are very clicky. Yeah. And if you're not in that click, it's real hard to try to get a job. That's one of the nice things about Black Hive. Like, literally everybody that works there they're their own person. They do their own things, but they also mesh really well with the entire vibe of the shop.
Isn't there another female tattoo artist?
Yes, Soleil.
Yes.
And she, and what's crazy is each one, you know, has a whole different style. So it's kind of interesting.
We all do things a little bit differently. We all work together collectively as a mindset, and it's a really nice environment. I've never worked in an environment like that, and I have traveled all over the goddamn world, and I have never seen a tattoo shop that has been run like that. And that type of mindset and the way that Nick does things.
Well, since you said something about the convention, you got one coming up, right?
Yes. The Imperial Tattoo Convention.
That's April, right?
Yeah. I think it's April 6th through April 9th.
April 6th through April 8th.
April 8th. Yep. Oh, excuse me. Adding an extra day on there.
Yep. So that
was... Yeah, we will be out there doing walk-ups. We are only bringing a limited number of designs that we are tattooing at the convention. And... we don't redo those designs that are done at the convention. Once they're done there at the convention, that's it. And we're not selling them otherwise. And I think I should have my shirts in by then. So you can come by and come pick up a shirt. And Nick should have new shirts.
You got your sheet done?
Almost.
Almost. I saw Nick's the other day.
Yeah. I've got some really cool flowers planned. And I've got some naked ladies planned.
I did see some of those. I mm-hmm. really like those.
Yeah.
She did some pretty cool.
You should add a naked lady to your repertoire.
I still haven't tattooed art. I don't know if he's going to let me.
Well, so this is the thing with people that tattoo me. There's only two people allowed to tattoo me, and that's Nick and Selina.
Oh.
Yeah.
No lie. No, those are the only two people I'm
allowed
to tattoo.
Oh, Nick told you you're allowed to get tattooed by me now?
No, this is what I said.
Oh, okay.
There's only two people that I'll allow tattoo me, Nick and you. I definitely want a piece from you, for sure.
Hell yeah.
I just have to... Nick has helped me finish off the sides, tie up the back. We're going to finish mm-hmm. the sleeve. And then once I finish those things, I want to talk to you a little bit and maybe we can get something going.
Yeah. I haven't.
I love your work. Your work is amazing. As a matter of fact, anytime that I see somebody out in town, I'm like, who did you tattoo? I was like, yeah, that looks like her work. Her shit's dope. Her shit's so dope.
Yeah. She actually just finished. I think the African sleeve is finished, right?
I just finished that one. Yeah. That one has been a year and a half in the works, and that's actually on... a gal, where the hell is she? She's somewhere in South Florida. She drives like 4 hours to come see me and has been doing that for a year and a half monthly.
Speaking of driving, you build cars too.
I do.
What was your last build?
Well, I have two on the lift right now. Right now, I am working on an 89 Jeep Cherokee. It's the XJ. So I'm an asshole and I really don't like most Jeeps. I'm sorry, Jeep owners out there. Your pavement princess doesn't have anything on my little XJ. Sorry. It's a shit box. I don't care, but it'll go through anything. Cars has been a big part of my life. The guy that taught me how to tattoo was real big into drag racing, and me and my dad built my first car. So,
which was?
It was an MGB. It was a 76 MGB.
Isn't that a British
It's a little
car?
British. Yeah, it's a little British roadster.
Those are dope.
Yeah, it was a cool little thing. Yeah, we had that thing.
I mean, it didn't have a lot of horsepower, but it looked great.
It weighs like nothing. So like 100 horsepower is going to scoot that whole thing like nothing.
That's true.
Yeah, it was like the old Porsches from back in those days. They didn't have a lot of horsepower, but they literally only weighed about 900 and something pounds of fuel tank.
Well, yeah.
It was nothing.
But they had like 200 horsepower.
Yeah. Yeah, so, I mean, they were fun. Yeah. You could sling them around.
Yeah, I'm working on the XJ right now. I put a 4.5-inch lift on the front, and then we put coilover shock strut mounts in the rear and raise the ass end of it about 2.5 inches. I require adult supervision when it comes to working on some stuff with cars because I know a lot, but I know enough to get myself in trouble. So I have to make sure that I have somebody there who is better with like suspension stuff.
I like all that. Looking on my Snapchat because she puts a lot of her stuff sometimes on her stories or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The progress pics are just dope. I'm like, oh, that's all fucked up. And it's so nice at the end.
I pulled the front clip and the bumpers last night off the XJ, and I did some hand blocking, and then I pulled the headliner out and started doing some repair work on the roof. I'm an interior auto person. Like, the interior of a car is totally my jam. Like, I will rip that to pieces and I will put it back together and make it look awesome. That is my shit. And I'm now getting into like body work and wanting to learn how to weld and start messing with that. So
go ahead and get you a good little MIG welder.
Yeah, that's what I want. I've had a couple people like, hey, you should probably go get this one, or saying like some kind of capacity of that.
Well, I was taught on stick, and it was one of those things I was taught. It's like, if you can stick weld, then you can use TIG or MIG. Mm-hmm. But nowadays it's really hard to find somebody that teach you how to stick weld because nobody really stick welds that much no more.
Yeah, my dad, he does stick welding, and I've got like a couple other friends that do like stick welding, but I'm probably just going to wind up with a MIG welder because I've got a shop behind my house.
It's so easy with a MIG welder. All you do is you turn a dial. You don't have to jack with sticks and shit.
Oh, yeah.
So what's the other build?
The other build is an 84 Monte Carlo. I found a barn find.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's my baby.
I love Monte Carlo.
Dude.
Her name is Shay, and she is a white 84 Monte Carlo. It's an LS.
That sounds about right. Yeah.
That's, cool. That's my baby.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Are you trying to keep it original?
So I'm an asshole, and I'm going to wind up with 2 G-bodies because I can't help myself. They're kind of like popcorn or potato chips. You can't have just one. I'm kind of obsessed with it. So she's going to be my cruiser. She's a barn find. She has 33,000 original miles on her in pretty much mint condition. So,
oh, wow.
She sat in a barn for like 25 years, and I bought her from a kid who joined the Air Force, and I only paid $5,000 cash for her. So,
wow. Yes.
Where'd you find her at?
Valdosta, Georgia.
I about to say, that's Georgia is the spot, bro. I drive through there all
the
time.
It's a sweet spot, man.
You can go. That's where my dad found one of his trucks. That's where my uncle's found a couple of his trucks. My buddy found his 62 Impala.
Yeah.
I got my eye
on an 87 Cutlass Supreme 4-door that was sitting out by my dad's house. Man, oof, that's a pretty car too.
See, I'm just lucky I don't have a garage that I can actually put a car in and work on, or I would be in the same
It's
boat.
Trouble because I have a 1500 square foot garage. So
yeah. Oh. So that's why she's got the space. She's got the space to play.
Yeah, shit.
So that's the only thing that's kept me in budget is that I don't have the space to play.
I also don't like having car payments. Like, I had what I like calling my Brad Pitt, fuck everything, fuck this, fuck you,
fuck
everything.
Yeah, that was, 2 years ago?
No, that was when it started. It didn't, like, get to the point where I was like, I'm fucking selling my goddamn truck until, like, last October. Like, last October, I had, like, the holy shit meltdown where I was like, I'm selling everything.
Yep, she went classic. Just got rid of everything and went back to classic stuff.
Yep, it's easier to work on. I ain't got to worry about it.
Are you strictly into American cars, or do you like
anything? No, I love all types of cars. Oh, yeah? I've owned everything from a 2013 STI hatchback. That was a 500 horsepower car.
I love that.
Oh my God, I love that fucking car.
Dude, I'll tell you, man, she's fun.
So that shit took off and flew, right?
That thing was evil. I sold it because I really am very good at driving fast, and I do not need to own anything that quick. So I'm about to start doing a little bit of drag racing and get my NHRA license again and start drag racing my buddy's cars.
I'm like, I like cars. I don't know much about them, but I love looking at them.
Well, that's all you got to do. You can appreciate them.
Dude, just go to car shows and go talk to people and ask questions. Like, I didn't learn all this shit overnight. Like, it takes
YouTube.
A while.
I'm fascinated.
YouTube's fantastic.
I'm like into the whole Street Outlaws shows.
Yeah.
I watch all of them. Like, now they got like Twin Turbo. That's another show. Then Shifting Gears with Aaron Kaufman, Fast mm-hmm. and Loud. I watch all those shows.
Yeah.
It's just like either anything car related or motorcycle related or cooking. Yeah. That's what I watch.
Yeah. Cooking's yeah, been my kick
cars,
this week.
Cars, metal, tattoos, drawing and hanging out. I mean, that's pretty much my life, and collecting records.
Honestly, I just got into that too.
Oh man,
the vinyl. I just raided some of my. I took three from my dad. I've got them over there.
It's dangerous, dude.
I've got the original Woodstock.
Stop now while you're ahead.
I know. Stop now. No, I almost. It's bad. Well, it's getting expensive.
I know.
I actually found a Heart album that I wanted. It was at one of the shops, and mm-hmm. I was picked it up. I was like, oh yes. And I looked at the price tag and went, fuck you. Mm-hmm. No, I'm not spending $45 on
it. I'm a nut for old like breakbeats and like house and vinyl, like electronic. Vinyl's kind of
coming back now though.
It right? is. Yeah.
Like, I hear people buying it all the time and like they're making new vinyl.
Yeah, they're making new vinyl again and they're starting to do some stuff. And I've started collecting like a lot of like classic rock and like classic like metal stuff. Like I have like original Slayer LPs and like I have... good Lord.
I got some Janis Joplin over
yeah,
there.
Yeah, I'm blanking out on like some of the stuff that I have, but I can't not possess the music and it just sounds different on yeah. record. It really truly does.
We did 2 hours yesterday with the, cause Tegan had one of her friends stay over and we were doing the music trivia off of YouTube, had the Bluetooth speaker downstairs blaring and going, okay, who's this? Okay, who's this?
If that's you find cool. some Menudo, fine, let me okay. know.
All right, Selina. I know you got to go because you've got to.
Yeah, I gotta go. Actually, funny enough, I'm going to go look at a car with a friend of mine because she wants to get a G body. And
which one?
We're going after. I think it's an '87 SS Monte Carlo. I found a really really nice one, and I'm hoping it's cherry because the body looks like it's straight. All yeah. the lines on it are intact. Car sounds good. The exhaust is still the original. It's an SS. It's a true SS. So it's got the floor slip shifter and everything else. So I'm hoping to go get my hands on this car to see if it's worth it.
If I ever had money to buy one of those older cars, I would get a Buick Grand National.
Believe it or not, it's
I
not
am
a
fucking obsessed with those goddamn cars.
I don't know like, why.
I am obsessed. No, you're talking like the 20 Grand to 30 Nationals grand.
Yeah.
20 to 30 grand. Yeah.
Just the little symbol alone is dope as fuck.
Yeah.
I have the biggest lady boner for a goddamn Grand National. I cannot help myself. And I almost got stupid and bought one because there was one that came up for sale for like 10 grand last week. And I was like, motherfucker, I can't do it right now. But god damn it, I want that
Why
car
Why
do
they only make it 1 year?
I don't know. I don't fucking know.
Well, see, I'm in the same boat because like my big vehicle that I want is I want one of the bug wagons from back in the day. 68.
But good luck. No.
Well, that's the thing. You can find them. But the problem is even a roller chassis is $35,000
yeah,
now.
Yeah, easy.
And it's
easy.
Like, bro, there's some. I've got to spend another $50 into this thing.
Yeah.
No, I can't do it.
The amount of fabrication and like welding and like all that shit is just, nah, I'm good. I'm good.
Nope, I haven't been able to find one yet. Each one I find, it's just it's too much. I'll have to, next time I'm in the shop, I'll have to get my dad to send me the pictures of his two trucks and you'll freak.
Dude, yeah. Somebody in your neighborhood around here has got a Chevy C10 Cheyenne that they dropped a Corvette engine into. An
yes.
LT1 Corvette. And I yep. about fell the fuck over when I,
know,
I saw
I know
that
you're
thing
they're up in
your...
the front of the neighborhood.
Yeah, I lost my shit when I saw that. I
had a 95 Z28 with an LT1.
Did you?
Hell yeah. Those yeah. are fun. Those,
that
I would
fucker
drive the
would
dog
scream
snot.
Every oh, time I got on it. But it gave me too many problems. I had to let it go.
Yeah.
Yeah, high compression rate on those kind of cars. Like, there's a lot of upkeep and maintenance involved with stuff. And once one thing starts failing, then yeah. you got to go through and fine-tooth comb everything.
It starts snowballing if you don't catch it beforehand. Yeah.
And I didn't have the money to just pour into it. And I'm like, you know what? Honda Civic, you're my new best friend.
Yeah.
Man, there's nothing... I can't tell you how many Hondas that I have owned over the years, but you cannot shake a stick in a damn Honda, man. You will always find parts for them, and it's cheap as fuck to fix them.
Yep. That's what makes them great, and normally they last. I mean, mm-hmm. they're a good 10-year vehicle. Yeah. I mean, knock on wood, I'm still – my Excursion's 04.
What engine's in that?
The 6.2.
It's the 6.2 in
yeah,
that
it's
one?
The smaller one.
Oh, okay.
I didn't go – luckily, it doesn't have the big one because the bigger one had all the issues. Mine, yeah. the smaller one, even though it's tuned – I mean, it is tuned to the point to where it'll
it
could
diesel?
Snap. Yeah, oh, fuck yeah.
Oh, it's that turbo
yes,
diesel.
It
yeah,
is.
Buddy.
Yep.
You can get 400,000, 500,000 miles out of that damn thing before you got to rebuild
yep.
it.
Yep, I'm only at 162. So it's
seriously?
Yep, it's just starting to get into that broke in stage.
You need to cut me loose and let me detail that damn thing.
No. Mm-hmm. Everybody, Amanda's wanted to lift it and do all this other shit. And I'm like, no, leave it alone.
No. I'm saying detail, like clean it up. Detail,
clean it up. I got to do some body work to it until I get, I've got that front quarter panel that's got a little crinkle in it that dad.
Does it?
Yeah, dad backed into, he swung around into a mailbox for me. Up in Atlanta, up into an icebreaker.
I need to look at it and see if I can help you because I got a lot of the tools now.
I got to do that, and I want to get a new front bumper because there's a little spot that's kind of rusting on the front on the bumper that I need to do. So, but
well, listen, we know she's got to go. Before we go, Art, why don't you give a shout out to our sponsors?
Lean Impact Nutrition for all your nutritional needs. Doesn't matter if you're a performance athlete or an average Joe looking for a six pack. Get a hold of Zach Elkins. You can go to leanimpactnutrition.com or hit him up on Facebook or Instagram. Also, Black Hive Tattoo. Get on their newsletter if you want to get a tattoo by the best tattoo artist in town, all of Jacksonville, and this has been voted. You need to go on to blackhivetattoo.com, sign up for their newsletter. They'll let you know when they have spots available.
All right, Chris, anything else you want to add?
No, get on the newsletter. I believe, I don't know whose books are getting ready to open up soon. I know one of the two is.
Soleil or Colby is going to be opening up next.
Ooh, so they're both fun artists.
They are fucking fantastic. If you want one of the best tattoos ever, please, 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 please go get tattooed by them. They are amazing artists.
Cool. Well, guys, we're also going to release our card cast that we did yesterday because Art and I went down to see Joe Rogan, and it's about a 30-minute, podcast. So we're going to release this one today as well as the card cast. Because we will not have an episode next week. Chris is going to be in Mexico. Art's going to be in Michigan. And I'm going to be chillaxing.
Nice. Little recharge.
Yeah, for sure. All right. Yeah, anything else you want to add?
No, sir. Take care of my dog.
You know I will.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
That's it.
All right, bro.
All right, guys. Well, thank you very much for listening. We appreciate your support. And we'll catch you in a couple of weeks. Peace. Yeah. Yeah.